take it off the screen. Okay, I'm ready.
Everyone's ready?
Yeah.
I'd like to call the Assiniboine Community Committee meeting to order. Today's Tuesday, September 12th, 2017. It's 4:35. We have with us today Councillors Gillingham, Councillors Morantz. I'm the chair today. I'm Councillor Dobson. Our urban planner, Devin Clark, is here, as well as Mr. Recker. And our clerk today is Ms. Cohen. The first item, oh no, we have delegations. Yeah, okay.
I'll move the adoption of the minutes from our last meeting.
Adoption of minutes, thank you.
Call a question? Sean?
Hmm?
Council, you have to call a question on the minutes.
Passed. Delegations today is Andrew Watch from A&W Architects. It's for your plan approval at 555 Sterling Lion Parkway.
Yes, Andrew Walk Architects. I'm here on behalf of Tangerine Online Banking Division of Scotiabank. And what they're looking to do is on the parking lot at, I guess, the outlet mall in, I'm not sure what part of town exactly that would be called, Southwest Winnipeg, is there's a pad site, small pad site. They would like to put a temporary building, which is what they call a pop-up. It's currently on North Main right now. It's been there for just over a year. It's a self-contained unit. It gets the city, it gets a permit approval from the Plans Examinations Department. It's fully compliant with everything within the city. It has a complete accessible washroom in it. It's self-sufficient. All garbage, waste, etc., is taken from the site on a daily basis by staff of the Tangerine or contracted out to, by people from Tangerine. Tangerine is not an actual bank. It's an online. Tangerine is a bank. It's an online bank. It does not have physical facilities. It does not have ATM machines. There'll be no money in this particular area here. It's the place for what would be called, 21st century banking, where you no longer deal with money. You no longer deal with going to banks. You do everything online. Mortgages, car loans, banking, investments, etc., all online. So this is more of an information center than it is an actual bank. It's considered to be a temporary occupancy by Plans Examinations of the City of Winnipeg, so it usually gets a one-year temporary permit. So it's here for information. It's there for people to go and say what exactly is online banking and how can it, how can we access it and make use of it for ourselves. So it's an information center. They're very nice. They're well put together. The interior has three workstations, basically staff people, and a place for coffee, and they're fully self-contained. So it comes in, sits down, a year later it gets picked up and moved away.
So my question, of course, was going to be, it's just a temporary...
It is just a temporary installation.
Okay.
Is that a train car?
Pardon?
Is that a train car?
It is. It's a container. It could go on a truck also, by the way. But generally speaking, you see them on trains. Yes.
So, has your client entered into a lease with Ivanhoe Cambridge or whoever is managing the?
They have a pending lease, depending on approvals and permits. Yes, they have. Yes.
Do you know what the term of the lease is?
It would be the occupancy of the thing, which would be 1 year, and likely a period of time to set it up. So this unit is currently at North Main. Pending agreement that this can be put down, it would take us probably up to 3 to 4 weeks-ish to get a permit from the City of Winnipeg. We already have a permit for the original one, so we're not expecting that there'll be, it's already been reviewed in previous applications. It's been approved, so we expect that the approval would be fairly quick, but still a month is fairly a fair number with the city. which would mean then it would have to, we'd have to organize for it to be picked up, brought to the site, put down, and then integrated into the system.
And the one on North Main, is it also a temporary permit?
It is, yes.
And how long is it to be there?
Probably it opened the spring of a year ago, so it would be there now 14 to 16 months.
Are there any others in town?
No. Well, there's other. There are other, not tangerines. There are other installations like this. Assiniboine Park has three containers at the Lyric Theater site, which they use for bathrooms.
Yeah.
University of Manitoba has a bike shop on campus that they use for bikes. There may be a couple of other ones that I don't know about. Just we get many calls on these, by the way. When they go down, everybody phones right away and asks if they can use it for a used car lot.
So, just out of curiosity, the washrooms, they're on their own system, right? They're not tied in with the city?
They're not tied to
and
the system.
What's the reason for that?
Well, usually in the middle of the parking lots. I mean, these are temporary, so it becomes a permanent, it would be considered a permanent facility if it connects to the city's systems. So if you think about a development like a condominium development in some part of the city, there will often be a sales office on site. So those sales offices will usually be a form of an ATCO trailer or something like this. If that's a temporary permit. Those usually don't have washrooms. So the city allows for these kinds of installations based on, you know, temporary marketing, temporary sales offices, construction offices, etc.
So is the actual intent that this be temporary?
Yes, well, that's what it is. It has to be temporary.
So that it might be. So you might decide to. Your client might decide to remove it after a year, or is that?
No. Well, we can only get a permit for a year, so it has to come out after a year. Like all of this is set by the city. The city has a standard on that it cannot be there for more than.
Okay. So it will be. I'm just trying to get a sense of how long it'll be there.
It'll be there a year, but usually there's a month front and back in order to pick it up and move it and all this kind of stuff. So it could be 14 to 16 months is the actual reality of it sitting in one spot.
So the intent is actually for it to really be temporary, that your client will actually remove it?
Yes.
After a year, and it won't be there anymore?
Yes.
Is that the intent?
Yes. Same as North Main. This is on North Main right now, so it'll be removed from North Main.
Oh, okay.
This is not a new one.
So this is the one that's coming. It's coming from North Main.
It's coming from North Main. It's coming from Main Street.
I see. Okay.
2465 Main Street.
That's interesting. Okay, I didn't realize that. Okay, so that helps fill in the picture a little bit more.
Yes, sir.
For me. I appreciate that, your answers there. Okay, great.
Councillor Gillingham has a question.
Mr. Chair. Just a couple. Do you know, was this one, there was one on McPhillips. Was this one on McPhillips prior to Main being on Main?
No. Yes, we have wrong McPhillips.
Okay, so to your knowledge, then, are there other, like you said, you see the park, those are permanent structures utilized for washroom facilities in U of M. But to your knowledge, is there any other business that's kind of following the tangerine? Very innovative model, innovative concept, but to your knowledge, is there any other business in Winnipeg that's following the same kind of model where they're using a shipping container, nicely painted, and placing it temporarily in about the city? Or is Tangerine the only one doing this?
As far as I know, it's only Tangerine. No, we have, as I said, we have had a number of telephone calls. When we put these down, people find out who was involved in doing it, so they phone our office. Yeah. And they become, the attractive aspect of it is if you actually go inside this building, it's very nice inside. It's fitted out very, it's got, you know, monitors hung from the ceilings. There's glass all the way around the perimeter of it. It's open, it's airy. It's small, it's 350 square feet. It's like a living room. So people phone because it's an ideal, as I said, like if you had a large used car lot or even a new car lot where you could have four salesmen out in the middle of the lot, it's a perfect situation where they can do this. And so people phone and say, you know, can you give me some information on this? I'd love to look at doing this. But when they find out what it costs to do it, it usually changes their mind really quickly because it's not cheap. You have to buy the container and then, of course, you have to insulate it. And these are self-contained. They have a complete heating system to them. They have a complete water system to them. They have hot water tanks. They have holding tanks, pump-out systems. These are very sophisticated things. These cost I would suggest in excess of $250,000. So once you start to look at that, and then they're temporary. So you put it down, you got to pick it up and take it away sooner or later. So Tangerine uses the same model, and so this way they can be in North Winnipeg, so now South Winnipeg, maybe West Winnipeg, you know, in a year. And then just sort of make sure that it's, they get their name out.
And so the process is wherever Tangerine may want to go, and in this case the LDEB Mall parking lot is, or property right. somewhere, the process is enter into negotiations, obviously, with the landowner or the managing for a lease agreement on the space, and then a permit required from the city.
Precisely.
Any other aspects of the process that?
Well, the only thing that comes up that's of concern that we handle for Tangerine and for the city of Winnipeg is one. Is because it's a temporary building, it's sitting on a pad. The city would like to make sure that if there happens to be a large-scale windstorm or a tornado or something like this come through, because it doesn't have a permanent foundation, it won't tip over. So we provide it where it's secured to the concrete base of the parking lot to make sure that it's stable. That's one thing. Secondly, it needs power. But the parking lots all have power and all provided within the lighting systems and all that stuff. So we usually get power fairly easily from the site.
And it looks from the picture, it's fully accessible. Is that right?
It is fully accessible. And the washroom is fully accessible in it to current day Manitoba Building Code standards, which are the most strident in the country.
What about fire prevention codes?
Oh, it's fully conforming to you know, it's a commercial. I mean, depending on how you want to have this conversation. I mean, it's a, in the first case, it's 350 square feet. So that means it's Part 9 building, which is considered a small scale building. It could be a wood frame construction, it could be of combustible construction. This is of steel construction, so it's non-combustible. At 350 square feet, you couldn't put more than five people in there. So that means it only needs one door to get out. It has two, etc. So it's well in conformance of all building codes and all that kind of good stuff.
Okay. If I could, can I just maybe ask our planners a question as I throw my pen at it?
You get his attention.
I just like, right now we're going to ask a question. I mean, this is a relatively, something like this is a relatively new concept. I mean, Cinnamon Park utilizing storage containers, which they basically worked in, those are more permanent. They're not moving from place to place. This concept, has the department contemplated kind of rules and regulations around this kind of thing, or have you been dealing with this on an ad hoc kind of one-off basis as each request comes up, or maybe just, I guess, what does the department do with this? Let's just put that.
I can speak to that.
Peter,
sure. Well, I guess a few things. We have to look at what the process is on our end. The reason it's here today is because there's a plan approval clause on the site that requires us to review any sort of development that takes place here. So on that end, we look at it and say, is this an appropriate location? Does it, you know, integrate into the site well? Does it work? Is it accessible? All of those things. So on that end, we've done that review, and it does. Obviously, we went back and looked into, you know, code compliance and bylaw, you know, regulations to just ensure that we're not allowing this, you know, this space to set up that will be a safety issue or anything like that. So from our end, that's basically been our take on it. Does it fit with the site, and is it meeting the necessary regulatory review?
Okay.
Thanks.
Thank you very much. Okay. Great. It looks good. Thank you.
I guess, am I done, or?
We'll have to go. You might want to wait a few minutes, because I think what we should do is maybe just
bump this up.
Just bring this plan up and deal with it, and then you can be on your way.
Okay.
Yeah, we can do the reports right away. We can move right into report number six.
Okay. So I'll make it quick. Actually, I'll move approval of the plan.
Okay. All those.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. All right, so that's quicker than I expected.
Thank you.
Nice meeting you.
Okay,
bye-bye. Okay.
Okay, report number one, community incentive grant for St. Amant, the Foundation Incorporated.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This was brought to our attention through the efforts of Councillor Mays, councillor for St. Vital. The St. Amand Center is located in his ward. I think we all know the reputation of the St. Amand Center and the unbelievable work it does for citizens of Winnipeg who are either cognitively or physically challenged or both. And so I was delighted when Councillor Mays brought this to our attention. They have made a grant request under our community incentive grant program. Councillor Mays' community committee has the grant request in total is $15,000. Councillor Mays moved approval at his committee last night of $10,000 towards that grant, which has been approved. I would like to also contribute from our community committee's community incentive grant allocation $2,500 from the Charles Wetuxedo White Ridge ward allocation. Let me just talk a little bit about this, and I understand Councillor Dobson would also like to move $2,500 from his allocation. So if it's all right with you, Chair, I'll move your allocation for you.
Please do.
Just because we'll do it alone.
What are your balances? What are your moves? 2,025?
$2,500 each.
Yeah. Okay. So that would round out the full request of $15,000. 10 coming from the St. Vital ward and another $5,000 coming from our committee. Just to talk a little bit about what the application is for, the center is requesting funding through the Community Incentive Grant Program to make the front doors of 440 River Road accessible. The front doors affect hundreds of people, especially those who access services at St. Amand's main building, their family and friends who come to visit and to attend information sessions and family consultations, as well as the general public who volunteer or attend fundraising events at the location. In addition, emergency and stretcher services will benefit from the renovated front doors. In winter months, the stretcher can only enter one set of doors at a time due to winter delay setting, which means the stretcher must be turned sideways so the first set of doors can close and the second set can open. In an emergency time, it is of the essence that the current door system slows down emergency personnel. The new door system will eliminate this significant problem and will allow emergency and stretcher services to access the building in a quick and timely manner. So that gives us sort of a general flavor of what the grant is for. And with that, I would like to move $2,500 from the Charles Wetuxedo White Ridge allocation and $2,500 from the Assiniboia St. Charles Ward, St. Charles Ward allocation from the CIG program.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Aye. Passed. Carried.
Okay.
Okay. Report number two is an extension of time for the proposed subdivision and rezoning of Ridgewood South opposite Cardiff Avenue and north of CNR Mainline.
I'll move the extension set forth in the report to July 31st, 2019.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Carried. Number three is a Land Dedication Reserve Fund, Pembina Trail School Division Education Support Fund Incorporated, Beaumont School Playground Improvement Phase 1.
Yes, this is an excellent program. The Beaumont School approached me some time ago about it. And the details of the grant request are set out in the report. And I would like to move that the LDR grant for the school be approved in accordance with the terms of the report.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Carried.
Okay.
Okay.
And that was in the amount of $13,000?
Yes, and sorry, in the amount of $13,000.
Okay.
Yeah.
Plan approval. This is number four, plan approval, 1225 St. James Street. This is Councillor Gillingham's ward.
Thank you.
wonder, Mr. Chair, Mr. Clark can just, Mr. Clark can just walk us through the details of this.
Yeah. So the proposal is for a commercial retail building located on presumably a future pad site that has been grassed over and just sort of maintained as that for the last several years. But essentially, they're proposing a new building there that would be about 10,500 square feet. There's a pedestrian connection from the sidewalk that extends to the front of the building, which is a requirement, and it means that. Garbage enclosures, there's a condition in the zoning agreement that the garbage enclosures be set back behind the building so as to not be visible from the street. They've met that condition as well. And
so you get the, I recall you garbage enclosures on the east side of the building, right?
Exactly.
Yeah,
yeah,
yes.
Right there.
All right. Thank you.
Yeah. And then parking, the addition of the commercial building still. The site still needs the required parking for both the existing retail and the new commercial development. So all in all, and in addition to that, they're providing some fairly significant additions to the landscaping. Here we are. Maintaining the 13 existing trees. Adding an additional 13 trees was already there. Of 72 shrubs, bringing the total up to 124. So certainly site enhancements are taking place with the addition of this building, which we're certainly pleased to see. So as such, we are recommending approval of the plans.
So this is it here?
Correct, yeah.
And this is Wellington here?
That is correct.
So it looks like it's set back quite a ways.
Right. It's at the corner of Wellington and St. James Street.
It's really... Oh, I see. It's a, so is this a normal setback for the street?
It would be, if I can jump in, that was one of my questions, too. By the looks of things, I mean, the building to the north of it is the chamois car wash. Yep. The building to the north of that is Costco. And it looks like, according to the plans, it will be in line, that you won't jut out or sit back. It looks like it would be right in line with, if you're standing at, you know, south and looking north, they're all to line up,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, exactly. You know, I think from the plan perspective, our ideal is that we always, you know, strive for that urban form where the building is set up closer to the street. However, in this instance, there is an existing drive aisle that connects the two sites there. And certainly, you know, the form isn't so much as that urban character. That
are adding any like?
So can I just ask that would be access to this building would be through the wholesale sports parking lot?
They share the same parking lot.
They're going to share the same parking lot, so it'll be part of that development, that footprint.
Yes.
Okay.
Are they adding bicycle parking as well?
There will be. I didn't see anything in that, but that is would be on the assumption that it's it is meeting bylaw.
Well, I see something at the back here. It says bike rack 8 stalls. Is that new?
Yeah, I suppose that is then. Okay. Yeah,
because the other two have it.
Yeah,
that's the requirement of the bylaw, and they're meeting the intent of that.
Yeah. Oh, great.
A couple questions I still have on this. So there's no additional approaches, egresses, or whatever like being proposed, right, on the St. James. Does your department have any concern whatsoever about this kind of flow through that allows people to avoid going onto St. James? They go from this parking lot, Tim's wholesale parking lot, to the chamois and vice versa. Could this be problematic if you've got increased traffic, pedestrian traffic, people parking their cars here? Is it an abundance of caution? Should this be closed? Should it not? Is it whose property is it? Does that belong to Chamonix, or does that belong to?
Yeah, it's a mutually shared approach. It's existing as is today. The raised concern about additional foot traffic or vehicle traffic as to access that building, it's possible. The connection from the sidewalk is a delineated space that would be identified for pedestrian crossing. Certainly, yeah. I mean, more commercial space will increase the traffic there, but I'm not sure it's to a degree that would be unsafe.
And is this the property line?
Yeah.
So the grass, which is currently the grass space, belongs to the Chamonix owner?
Yeah.
Whoever owns the property, the Chamonix City Line?
Yeah.
So then, in theory, this is their approach or their lane?
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's shared. They must have, an agreement that allows for cross-access. I don't suppose it's very auto-oriented in the city. Safety issue, and given that we do have an identified pedestrian connection, we hope that does alleviate any sort of negative interactions between the two.
What's the cost of a? I guess a couple of questions. What's the cost of a speed hump there? And would it be warranted? And would it be the new proponent that would have to put it in place, or would it have to be the property owner? Could there be an agreement? I just, again, for the abundance of caution, I'm envisioning there's a restaurant, the plan talks about the concept of a restaurant. So you got families going to this restaurant, little kids, they get out of the car, they park here, and you got someone who's got a clean car ripping this way or someone going the other way. If there was a way to kind of mitigate the speed with which they travel through there, because you get two or three vehicles parked there, you can't see what's coming this way or that way.
Yeah.
And again, maybe it's an abundance of caution, but I'm wondering if it could be.
I suppose because we are dealing with the subject property at hand, if we were going to impose anything, that's where we can target it. It's difficult for us to say the adjacent property.
Install
that.
So it would have to be, an agreement between the proponent and to put that maybe even right at their property line.
I suppose what we could do is. Entertain that as a condition and say we will explore the introduction of a speed hump along this property line here.
Yeah, right there, right?
Yeah, exactly. So as to ensure that vehicles are slowing down for the pedestrian traffic. I think that's a great idea, actually. We could put it as a condition. That since we explore that. I don't imagine it's a very costly endeavor. I've seen them just more or less kind of laid down on top of the existing asphalt that might be there. I think that's fair for us to explore. We can go and consult with the architects, and perhaps it be as a condition that it would come back for the satisfaction of the director.
Yes, I agree.
Come back here.
Yeah, and I think my wording would be install and maintain.
Yeah.
Right? Because if the thing that we installed it once, 3 years later, it gets hit by it.
Exactly.
It gets plowed away. Yeah.
Install and maintain. So it's
right.
I really I'm pleased to see the addition of trees coming in. It's a bit of a concrete. It's all concrete in that area. There's a lot of concrete, so the fact that they're going to put some enhanced landscaping is welcome news.
Right.
Other than that, I don't think I have. It looks really good if it comes to fruition this way. So I don't have any other questions, Mr. Chair. Mr. Time.
No, I'm good.
So if that's the case, then I would I'd move concurrence with the report, the recommendation of the Urban Planning Division, with the one condition
to explore the installation and maintenance of a speed hump at which point.
At the property at or near the property line. To the satisfaction of the director.
Perhaps the north property line.
North property line.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, the next, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Okay, carried. The next report is a plan approval for 3700 Portage Avenue. Maybe I would like to move that, so could I ask the chair?
Sure, I will take the chair. What is it that they want to change?
So this is more or less, for lack of a better term, a facelift. They're just sort of readdressing the facade treatment at the Hyundai dealership on Portage Avenue. But you can see some of the elevation drawings that basically just show a new material treatment that is apparently more in line with the marketing strategy for Hyundai, I suppose. So essentially the requirement for plan approval was set when the site was rezoned several years back, 1986, I believe. And ultimately they've been required to come back to address the changes that they're doing to the facade and, you know, some of the surrounding features to the entranceway of the building.
Okay, any questions?
Well, I have one question. I thought I read that they were narrowing the lane in between the dealerships, but it doesn't appear so. They appear to be putting safety lines out. Okay, the yellow lines, number 13. New painted lines in safety yellow.
Number 11?
13.
Oh, 13. New painted lines in safety yellow. Right. Yeah.
Well, I drive through that area quite often, so that would be a welcome sight, because it is quite congested with all the cars there. And I think it's great that they're doing a facelift on their building, and it shows that they're planning to stay there for a long time. So if there's no other questions, I'd like to move.
Yeah, sure. It's nice to see they're putting in an electric vehicle charging station as well. Sure. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Carried. Okay, you have the chair.
Okay, I have the chair.
Here.
Report number 6, plan approval, 555 Sterling Line Parkway.
So we've done that one.
We've already done that one, so we're done.
I'll move adjournment so we can meet again in hearings. Do we have an extra one?
We do have a new business.
What's mine?
Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah. I was suspension.
Report number 7.
Thank you.
I'm voting against the adjournment motion.
Yeah. Okay. I'm out of
sorry.
Okay. Report number 7. Do we have to suspend the rules to see this one?
Suspension of the rules.
Okay.
Yeah.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Carried. Okay. Report number 7. Plan approval, 1600 Ness Avenue, Unit J. And that would be Councillor Gillingham's ward. It will just take us a minute, seeing we've just seen this.
What is here currently?
So this is currently a sushi train restaurant, and it's changing over into a little pizza heaven. And associated with that, they're establishing a patio outside where there used to be a planter. The planter has been removed since, and The site is zoned C4, so the size of the patio is in compliance with the bylaw.
Is this in the building where the Moores is and the
Commission?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. All right.
It's known as Madison Square. Yeah. It's a strip mall style development near Polo Park.
Yeah.
What are the dimensions on this proposed? I don't see it right. It's here, obviously, but I. Mm-hmm. What are the proposed dimensions on this patio?
So the total square footage of this patio is about 450 square feet in area, with about plus minus 44 seats per dining. It's about 25 by 18 in size, and it will be enclosed with a 4 feet high powder coated aluminum fence.
So does their current liquor license extend to the patio, or would they have to get an additional liquor license, or how does that work as far as, are they allowed to, maybe is the establishment even licensed?
I don't think the establishment is licensed.
Okay, all right.
At least their Little Pizza Heaven and their other locations are not licensed.
Okay, let me preempt my question. Okay. Mm-hmm. You said up to 44 seats?
That's correct. And the site is zoned C4, so under the bylaw they are able to go quite to the size that they're proposing for the patio.
What about their hours of operation?
Their hours of operation, it would be whatever is under their agreement with the strip mall, I would imagine.
And so would the hours of operation for the patio be the same as the hours of operation for their dining room?
Presumably, yes. Usually when we have patios that are more in public spaces along sidewalks or visible from residential areas, we sometimes have other conditions about removing patrons from the patio by a certain time. In this case, the patio is internal to the site. It's minimal impact. It's commercial properties all around, so there's no concerns regarding that.
There are apartment buildings to the east, but there's quite a, there's a long distance there.
It is, yes.
The sound would have to travel up and over the building and across the parking lot.
That's correct. Okay. Mm-hmm.
We approved a patio, I think, if I got this right, in the same or the adjacent strip mall just to the south for, is it One Great Brewing Company or something, right?
Along same, the same.
It's like a long north, mess right there.
Yeah. We approved that. What was their seating, do you remember? Oh. Close to the same, wasn't it, or no?
I think a little less.
This is 44.
I don't call it being that high.
Okay. All right. I asked that question because, just because there's precedent in the area for this approval and for outdoor patio, and it's except for traffic coming in and out of there, vehicle traffic, people, unless they go in that restaurant, there's not really much else to hold people hold people there. So okay. And there's no parking right up against the patio, is there? No.
No, there's
the
not.
The parking lot is adjacent, so there's no, should be no chance that someone's going to park and bump into the patio because the parking is not along the patio.
That's correct. Wall. It's a drive aisle along that side, and then there's actually 6 feet of sidewalk space, and then the patio. Okay. So there's enough space for pedestrian circulation around the patio, and then you get the patio, and 6 feet for the sidewalk, and then you get the drive aisle, and then you get the parking.
So is it the property owner or the business owner that's making the application?
It's the business owner.
Okay.
It's Matt Stevenson. He's associated with Little Pizza Heaven.
Okay. Okay. I have no further questions.
No, I'm okay.
Okay.
You've covered pretty well everything. If you want to put a motion for it.
Yeah, I'm prepared to move. We accept these plans, and well, I welcome the potential addition of a patio in this area. So, in favor.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Carried.
Okay. Motion to adjourn.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Aye. Okay.
And then, do we just reconvene right away? Okay, whenever.
Yeah.
Whenever.
We can reconvene anytime.
Okay.
Okay, I'd like to reconvene the Assiniboine or Assiniboia Community Committee meeting. This is for. Oh, am I still on the other side?
Yeah, right here.
Okay, I guess I have to introduce everyone again. This is Tuesday, September 12th. It's now 5:15. We have with us Councillors Gillingham, Councillors Morantz. I'm the chair, Councillor Dobson, and we have our planners, Mr. Clark and Mr. Rackhair, and our clerk, Ms. Cohen.
All persons who wish to speak or receive notice of the hearing body's decision or recommendation must fill out a public representation form and submit it to me as soon as possible. Copies of this form can be found at the registration table outside of the meeting room. In accordance with the City of Winnipeg Charter and the Development Procedures Bylaw, the process the committee will follow is the applicant will be heard first, followed by those in support of the application. Next, those registered to speak in opposition are heard, followed by those registered for information. Finally, the applicant may return to speak in rebuttal to comments made. However, no new information is permitted. Please note that when your name is called, it is your opportunity to speak. However, you're not obligated to do so. This is the public hearing process brochure, copies of which are available at the registration table. This brochure contains an overview of the process and other information pertaining to what happens before, during, and after a public hearing. As information, all public hearings are recorded and will be part of the public record. Should you have any questions after the public hearing is concluded, please contact the City Clerk's Department. Item 1 is a subdivision and rezoning at 860 St. James Street under file DASZ 11 of 2017.
Okay,
the applicant.
Okay. Mr. Fawcett? Yes, could you, if you'd like to take that chair, and could you give your name and your address?
Doug Fawcett, Fillmore Riley, 1700 360 Main Street.
Okay.
So I'm the applicant on behalf of Oxbow Holdings LTD, who owns the property subject to the subdivision and rezoning. As I'm sure you're all aware, a few years back there was an expropriation of St. Matthews Avenue that's created a mix of properties on the south side of St. Matthews that we're looking to clean up, reconfigure so we can develop on that property. The balance of the subdivision and rezoning is simply carving out the lot, which will be parcel D in the proposal. And we've also included parcel E as it's zoned M1 as well as the parcel D, which doesn't really, from our perspective, fit with the area, and rezoning to C3 would be more consistent with the development in the area. In summary, it's that simple. I don't really have much more to say on it than that. It's simply trying to clean up the title so we can actually develop on the property.
Okay. Any questions from councilors?
That's for our planner, Scott. Do the plan approvals have to come back at some point?
There is a plan approval clause.
There is. It is in here. Okay. All right. Okay.
A couple questions, Mr. Chair. Just so the property we're talking about is not the current property where that's all occupied right now by Pro Hockey Life. It's the properties to the north between there and St. Matthews, correct?
Yeah, so the properties between it includes the Pro Hockey Life title. That's part of what's happening.
Okay.
But it's that space between Pro Hockey Life and St. Matthews is the key area.
Okay. Currently, don't know if it's an actual official on the books kind of a road or not, but people do, you know, drive a bit of an alleyway there or a driveway there currently to the north, on the north side of Pro Hockey Life. The people go back and forth and sometimes get through onto Madison. Is that an actual formal alleyway, or is that just because of the nature, at the state of the development, people use it as access? you know?
I think the latter is the correct. I think it's
under the current state. Yeah, it's almost a gravel sort of access here off of St. Matthews that ties in with the asphalted surface for the developed area is.
Okay.
But.
With the proposed, okay, yeah, please, yeah. If I may.
With the proposed plans that we have, that sees that alleyway is
right.
No longer there, and a formal approach. I believe that approach is actually already
there. That approach is already there.
Yeah. 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 And then that approach remains as a back lane to the development, right. Which is, yeah.
Okay, so I just want to be clear that we're today, by doing this, there's no lane closure being done. Like there's no lane here. People do use it. They do access east west over eventually to Madison through like you say gravel. But there's no lane being closed. That there's nothing really prohibiting us from approving this, and then these lots could be consolidated, developed on or out.
Correct.
Right. It's privately owned land, it's not a city
There's a couple other questions I have then. I guess of the planner, if this is approved, what impact is there for parking in the area? Because at this point right now, I'm looking at Google Maps, an overview. There's a parking lot which is east of what is currently Save-On Foods and Pro Hockey Life, and there's park there. There's ample parking. It's never full. But if this is eventually developed north of Pro Hockey Life, where will the parking be? Will they be accessing this parking lot, or too soon to tell? Or what's from the planner's perspective? What's your thought on that?
Well, we've had this reviewed by our zoning administrators, and what that revealed is that there's 827 parking spaces that currently serve
this area.
This area. And with the addition of this new commercial retail space, the requirement would be actually 592. So they're already well above what it will be once it's developed out.
Okay. So currently, the parking here could accommodate the full development here?
That's correct.
Okay. Sorry to be here when you gentlemen can't see it. I apologize for that. Okay. There's five lots there to be... Reconfigure five lots and subdivide into five parcels.
That's correct.
Just out of curiosity, why apply for the C3 zoning for D&E and not the others?
They're already C3.
Oh. Sorry, it says rezone parcels from M1. Oh, I see. They're already C3, so this will make the whole site.
The intention is to clean it up so it's all C3.
Yeah, I understand.
Any other questions?
Just one more second.
Yes, go ahead.
Councillor, thank you. So you, was stated earlier, all plans would come back for review, landscaping, building, all of that would come back for approval.
That's correct, to the committee.
Okay.
Yeah, the list and the approval clause is the standard list: buildings, accessory parking, private approaches, garbage enclosures, fencing, landscaping, and signage.
So at this point, just subdivision rezoning, like you said, it's just to clean up the property. There's no buildings being proposed, no variances or anything like that. It's just subdivision rezoning.
We don't have confirmation on buildings yet. We need the next property in order to determine the building.
Okay. Yeah. Good. No, I'm fine with that. It makes sense. It would lead to the I'll use the word cleanup of that that little bit of land there. So
for development of it, yes.
Yeah, cleanup and ultimately. Thank you. That's what I trying to state. So that's good. So, thank you.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
So just have to walk through the. Okay.
Yeah, is there anyone else here in support? Okay, hearing no one. Anybody else? Yeah, anybody in opposition?
No one here. Anybody here for information? I believe. Just for information?
The back alleyway is amended for the hydro-regulator.
Would you like to come forward and speak?
Oh, no.
Okay. And that's all I got to do.
Okay, then if I can get to it. I can as soon as I find it here. I just want to make sure I got it.
Page 5.
Not the script. Which
five.
Page?
5.
Okay, I would move then that the report of the Olympic Public Service be taken as read.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. I move the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. I move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in and forwarded to, right to EPC?
Yeah, right, if there's no amendments.
To Executive Policy Committee via the priority rezoning process.
All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
And I move that the following supporting reasons be that this is an appropriate rezoning of these properties, to fit within the use of buildings and property in that strip. It's really a matter of, to use the term, cleaning up of a couple of properties after that have different zoning, and with the investments in St. Matthew and St. James, it's really been a revitalization to the area, and this will lead to future development that will fit within the context of this area.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay.
And I move that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Please note that the committee has made a recommendation on this matter that will now proceed to council. No further representations are permitted, and all persons registered for the public hearing will receive notice when the matter is considered by council.
Move for adjournment.
Okay.
Awesome. Okay. Meeting's adjourned.
Thank you.
This is yours.
Thank you.
I wrote that on 5 o'clock.
Oh, okay.
Page.